There's no time to lose, so let's get right after it. Let's say you're in prison, falsely in prison, and you escape from the prison. The guards are now chasing you with the bloodhounds. You're running through the forest, and you say, "What do I do? What do I do?" And you say, "Ah, I know what I'll do. I'm gonna make a dummy. I'll build it out of straw, put some clothes on it, a dummy, and I will climb a tree and put the dummy way up in the tree, hiding up in the tree. And then I'll climb down the tree and I'll jump away and go down a creek and run off." So the dogs come along. They smell the tree. They went up the tree and they're barking, barking. They're up in the tree and they look up and they see what they think is the escapee up in the tree. And so they're barking, barking, and all the guards get more guards come, and police and everybody. There's a big, they say, "Hey, come on down." They're trying to get him out of the tree, and finally they realize, oh my gosh, it was a dummy. Meanwhile, the escapee's off in the forest thinking, "Okay, I delayed them, but wait a minute. Eventually they're going to find out it was a dummy. So let's build another dummy." So they build another dummy, put it up in another tree. The dogs get back on the track and they track it down to this tree. They say, "Ah, okay, that's where it is." And they repeat the same situation, on and on and on. And the one that's escapee in the forest keeps building dummies and sticking them up in trees, putting them in caves, putting them places. And in that way, the pursuit continues, but always seem to be thrown off the track. This is a metaphor for our situation. Who are the dummies that we are constructing? Are these bodies? These bodies are dummies. And we're putting them in various situations to throw this pursuer off our track. This pursuer is what we think is an annihilator, out to annihilate us. Spirit is speaking. Spirit feels this way, that there is something that is trying to annihilate spirit and capable of annihilating spirit, that it has to be thrown off track and to go chase after these dummies that we keep making. So life after life after life is simply we're making dummies, placing them here in this world, like up a tree. So, and then imagining that they're being pursued by annihilation. Now, what when we, during the lifetime of these dummies, the dummies suffer all sorts of blows and troubles, and death keeps knocking on their door, etc. And this is to convince the annihilator that the annihilator is chasing after the right what chasing in the right place, looking in the right place, and it's already having effects upon the dummy. See, look. Look, the dummy is aging. Look, the dummy is getting sick. Look, the dummy is getting old. Look, it's dying. Look, annihilator. Look at the great effect you're having upon it, you see. And so then, and look how powerful you are. You are able to annihilate, you see. You're destroying this self. So this is a game that we're playing. In the previous video, I spoke about how this arises, the fear of annihilation. Death is a defense against the sphere of annihilation. It is a way to, we think, to throw the pursuer off the track of spirit and displace the pursuit onto these dummies that we have manufactured called bodies. And these bodies go through all sorts of trauma, etc., and then die. And we feel that this is evidence that the annihilator has been chasing the dummies instead of spirit. So spirit is conjuring up, imagining this whole scenario as a way to divert the pursuit of the annihilator, the boogeyman, from spirit, from looking at spirit and saying, "You're the one I have come to annihilate." And so this is a different way of looking at the world. What's important in these videos is to hear different perspectives, or perspectives you don't often get in the world, so that your mind can say, "Hey, wait a minute, you know, I hadn't thought about that." And so I just make the effort to bring up talk like this to help people consider and ponder on these alternative explanations for the situation here. And you will find that if you really follow, think about it and ponder on it, you will say, you know what, that really fits. At a deep level, that actually fits. It really does. So consider this narrative of the idea of throwing off the annihilator, the boogeyman, throwing them off the track by manufacturing bodies. What do we do in this world? We manufacture bodies. We're in the body manufacturing business, right? Well, we put all sorts of grandiose terms on it, like creating life, giving birth to life. Really. We're manufacturing bodies. Bodies are manufactured in order to die. They are dummies, as it were, being placed here as a means of supposedly to throw the annihilator off track and think that the annihilator, that the bodies are the self, that they are spirit, they are the self, they're life, and therefore the actual target of the annihilator. The annihilator is imaginary. It doesn't exist. It's not real. It's merely our own desire to change reality being felt. Imagine that it has effects. We're imagining that our desire to change reality has effects, okay? But it's imaginary. It doesn't have any effects. Our desire to change reality has no effects. We're imagining it has effects, hypothetically saying, well, what if it did have effects? If we could change reality, it would annihilate reality, because reality is one indivisible whole. So any change would be a complete obliteration of it all. We would cease to have any exist at all. It would be gone, vanished, nothing, annihilated. So we are simply imagining that we have the capacity to change reality. And we're imagining, therefore, we must also imagine that we have the power of annihilation. But the problem is that we are one with reality. We are reality itself, too. All aspects of spirit. So that means that the annihilation seems to be, that we are imagining, seems to be coming after spirit, coming after us. And so we're in desperately trying to avoid this imaginary annihilation, this effect we believe we're capable of producing, although we're not. We're not. It's not a real effect at all. It's all imaginary. So obviously when one realizes this, there's no more reason to produce these dummies we call bodies. I mean, let's face it, bodies, people, everything are dummies, literally and figuratively also. The world is not a smart place. It's a very dumb place. It's something that's just causes irritation in a lot of people. They realize, my gosh, what is wrong with this? This is an insane asylum. Really, it is. We're all so dumb. Bodies are dummies. They're not what we really are at all. And we just, they're like puppets. We have them acting like, in a certain way, then imagining that, oh, this means that the annihilator will see them as real and alive and the self and the target. We have them we try to make it seem that way in all sorts of crazy, convoluted ways. But we're really dummies. Bodies are dummies. People are dummies. Really dumb. That is a fact. But seeing this fact doesn't cause some collapse of the person or body or anything like that. No, because spirit just saying, ah, it's spirit that sees it. Says, huh, that's what I've been doing. So once this is seen and the annihilators, all this is just imaginary, then what need is there to produce another dummy, to place another dummy in the world and say, that's me. If you want to get me, that's where I am. With that body is me. That kind of thing. We're saying, this body is what I am. Therefore, annihilator, if you're going to get me, you're going to get this body. And of course, spirit knows that the bodies are not spirit. And we're just bringing this fact up to greater clarity and awareness and light. What would happen is we don't need to place any more bodies. We don't need to be. So the end of cycle of reincarnation, it's not necessary anymore, because there is no annihilator, there is no chase, there is no attempt to, no fear of annihilation. There's no need then to displace this fear off onto a body and saying that's what I am, that's my true identity, and go get it, and having killed the body, then we say, oh, see, Annihilator, you've annihilated the self. So now you're finished, you're done, you did it. It's a silly thing. We think the death of the body ends the hunt, ends it all. It's all ended because the Annihilator has got the self, destroyed reality, and that's it, finished. And then, of course, we're spirits hiding in the background saying, okay, now I can, I'm free and I can create a new reality. Silly game. So the silly game, once it's up, we say, oh, no need to incarnate, no need to have another body and saying, go get that body, go get that body, go kill that body. No need for it at all. Don't need to go through, continue on with this pain, this suffering, this threat, this vulnerability, all this. No need to build a dummy, another dummy. No need to identify with another dummy. So this is really a unique way to, and a fresh, unique way of looking at the whole spiritual spectrum. And if you can see it like this, it becomes simpler and simpler and simpler, and the entire thing can be resolved. All this mystery of the spiritual path and all this stuff, you know, just say, wow. It's all just very clear and can see. I don't need to produce any more dummies. Don't need to identify, so that's it. And this has all just been an imaginary what-if scenario. I cannot attack reality. I cannot change it. I can't do anything to it. So there's no need to fear that I'm going to be annihilated. And it just all just resolve, just all resolves simply and easily. So that's really the goal, is to keep simplifying it. Simplify, where you come up with an answer, a way of looking at it that doesn't give rise to more questions. It's like questions just all kind of like subside and say, ah, that answers it. Okay. That's what the aim needs to be. So when you're working on clarification, is if you get the feeling like, huh, I don't feel so many questions arising anymore, that's good. Whereas if you're working in a certain way that you suddenly feel all these questions arising, that's not good. That's not the right approach. You have to take a better approach than that. You know the situation when you get in a situation, it might be talking with someone or whatever, and it seems like all these questions, just so many questions keep multiplying. It's like, ah, that's what happens to me when I socialize with people. It's like their way of asking and this and that, it just causes all these questions to arise. But what you need to do is get a perspective where no questions arise. It just, it's all like, ah. That's how I feel now. No questions. Like, what is truth? What is it? No, it's just all quiet. It's all quiet as far as my mind goes. I have to actually work to keep my mind going, as it were, asking questions and trying to be active in some way. Because as far as this whole situation goes, existence, my mind is just kind of like is at rest. It does not really struggling anymore trying to find answers. So you can weigh your efforts that way of, do you feel like less questions arising, and do you feel like you're in less pursuit of answers for all these questions, or do you feel like you're actually getting more and more agitated with more and more questions? That's important. You can weigh it that way, and you can come up with your own narratives, your own metaphors, your own parables, your own way of looking at it. In fact, you have to, really. What I do is just, this just comes up on the fly. I'll just think of some narrative, like, this is a useful way to look at it. It's important to see the justification for no more lifetimes, no more births. And looking at this way of no need to produce any more dummies to divert the wrathful pursuit of the Annihilator, the boogeyman, that puts it in a really nice context. And you say, wow, I can see how it can easily be justified that you no longer identify. You've freed yourself from this terrible cyclical situation of continually needing to divert this imagined fury off onto a body, and then acting like the body is being tortured and traumatized, and saying to the annihilator, look, you see how successful, oh my gosh, you're really getting it, you've almost got it, you really are destroying the self, you're really destroying, it's amazing, this is terrible, it's so awful, trying to, you know, egg it on in that way as a way to escape, this for spirit to escape it. And you look at this, you say, aha, wow, interesting, very interesting, very relevant. And then, so then enlightenment, all this stuff takes on a different perspective, very different perspective. So it's worth it to keep working on the spiritual path, because you will come up with many different perspectives. And each one may, you know, settle it a little more for you. A little more settled, a little more settled, a little more settled. And it seems to go on for a long time. That's because the settling is quite a lot of settling that needs to take place, as far as realizing that you're finally free of this ghastly nightmare. It's almost like too good to be true, really. And that's kind of the hang-up. It's just like, how is it possible? This is just too good to be true. Can I really believe it? Can I really, will it be too much for me? And so by getting these different perspectives, you gradually say, huh, no, I can see that. It's not too much for me. It's obvious now, very obvious. I've just been displacing all the terror that spirit is afraid is going to happen to it, displacing it onto bodies and saying, that's where the death is occurring, that's where the trauma, that's where the annihilation is occurring, that's where the self is. And so that's where it's all directed to that. And of course, we manufacture evidence that the annihilator is annihilating bodies. So we think that death is happening to all these bodies, that suffering, sickness is happening to it from the annihilator. So that makes us feel safer. We say, oh, see, the annihilator is very much engaged with these bodies. Well, look at the evidence. Look at all this terrible suffering and death and everything, right? But we are actually doing that to the bodies ourselves. Spirit is doing it, not the annihilator, which is imaginary, doesn't exist. We're doing it to the bodies in order so that we can feel as if we think, oh, it's the annihilator that's doing it, you see. And therefore, that means the annihilator is engaged with bodies and not with spirit. So that gives us a sense of relief from the dread that we have. All right, so all sickness, all death, all suffering, all infirmity, everything is we're actually imagining that up and sustaining it and bringing it about because it lessens our dread, and because we think this is proof that the annihilator is engaged with bodies. It's proof. It's evidence, hard evidence, we think. We always breathe a sigh of relief as we see the suffering and misery about the world. We say, oh, I'm so relieved that the annihilator is really tooth and nail engaged with his bodies, and it thinks that this is real, this is the self, this is reality. You say, ah, that's great. It's not getting me. It's the misdirection is working. And so we're afraid to be blissful and happy and beyond and feel flawlessly perfect, like no death, no decay, no harm is happening to us whatsoever. We feel perfect. We're afraid of that because then we say, well, wait a minute, where's the evidence that the annihilator is after this body? Maybe the annihilator has decided that it's going to leave this body alone and go after spirit. You see, so that frightens us. So actually, you can have glimpses of liberation, salvation, and then you can go back into a situation where you actually become sicker then because you think you have a backlash and say, I feel perfect. I feel everything's perfect. And then you say, wait a minute. That means there's no evidence. I'm not experiencing any evidence that the annihilator is engaged with this body. So you say, I better make myself feel sick again really quickly. So then that relieves the inner dread. So this is a way of looking at, we always hear that we bring up everything about everything that happens, we bring it upon ourselves. But we're like, why? Why are we doing this? Why do we have these bodies? Why do we get sick and arthritis, get old, all the diseases of age, and the terrible, all your muscles are stiff and achy, and you get arthritis, your eyes are going bad, and you can't walk, you can't work, everything is become decrepit, you go towards decrepitude, you know, that's what happens. Is you going towards decrepitude, and then just basically you'll be lying like a vegetable in a bed, and then you'll die, you know, and this body goes through all that. Why? You know, here's the answer. Because we're simply doing this as a way to assuage a deep inner terror that we have of annihilation. As we're manufacturing this evidence that this imaginary annihilator is actively, super actively engaged with these bodies, bringing about all this terrible path towards annihilation and death. And then that makes us feel like we're safe from the annihilator because it is engaged with something that's not us. These dummies, this mirage that we've conjured up. That's why we do it. We don't have to do it, as a matter of fact. We don't have to get sick. We don't even have to age. The body doesn't have to even age. It doesn't have to die. It doesn't have to get sick. It can be actually absolutely flawless condition. Not the slightest sign of pain or suffering or limitation as far as fluidity of motion. Right this instant. But we are more afraid of feeling flawless than we are feeling decrepit. So we choose decrepitude instead. Because that makes us feel as if we say, oh, annihilator must be engaged with the bodies. Look at the evidence. Look at the evidence. It's wearing the body down. The body is exhausted. It is pummeling the body, you know, it is defeating the body, it is destroying the body, it is annihilating the body. And then you say, yeah, that's great. Because that means the annihilator believes the body is the self. And when the body then dies, the annihilator will say, okay, I've completed my mission and I'm finished. And then no more annihilator. And then spirit will breathe a sigh of relief and say, I escaped the annihilation. How clever I am. Spirit saying, oh, I'm so clever. So clever. So that's why we suffer. That's the root of suffering. That is the root of suffering. So this is a unique explanation. I've never heard it before. It just has come to me to explain it this way. Never read anything like this or studied anything like this. It just fits. It just fits. And deep down, I'm saying, yeah, this is true. I know this is true. Because I always think, like, why am I suffering? I know I don't have to suffer, but yet I choose to suffer as a feeling. I know I could feel perfectly well. But instead, I don't. I feel terrible. That's actually to try to dampen down this sense of great inner dread of annihilation. That's actually why we're all of us are going through this ridiculous charade, sending bodies through all these troubles, etc. So again, this is an alternative explanation to explanations you've heard previously, and for me it fits. It fits like a glove. It's like, aha. So what's the benefit of this? I don't know. But reason would tell you that it must be beneficial to be able to see it so simply and clearly, that it must have some benefit. I don't know how the benefit could accrue. But it sort of lets the cat out of the bag, really. And the mystery is solved. The mystery of existence is solved. So I don't know, again, what the next step is once you solve the mystery of existence. What's next? I don't know. I really don't. Probably go to bed and have stupid dreams again, you know, as always. And then get up in the morning and say, yeah, I know. The riddle of existence, the mystery of existence has been solved. Absolutely. There's really nothing else to solve. There's a few, you know, continuity issues of experiencing God's non-judgment upon all this silliness stuff, but that's been worked through already. But what's more important is, why are we suffering? That's what we really want to know. Why are we suffering? That's what I wanted to know in the world. That has been my goal in this life, is saying, why am I suffering? Why other people? Why are we suffering? Why is there suffering in the first place? Why is there suffering? What's the answer? And nobody knows the answer here. Yeah, nobody could ever give me the answer, which is incredible. And I said, that's bad. Nobody knows. And now we know. This is what's behind it all. People just don't like to talk about it. They say, no, we value our suffering so much, we don't want to see what it's all about, actually. Because then we might let go of it and say, no, we don't want it. And then we say, oh, but then annihilation will be terrified by it, because it won't be, it's evidence that it's leaving, decided to turn away from bodies. And now what is it turning to? What else could it be except spirit? You see, there's that inner dread. So we just avoid looking too deeply at suffering. We avoid it. And so we come up with all these pseudo explanations. I mean, you know, when you're trying to track it, suffering down, you come across so many pseudo explanations. Thousands and thousands and thousands. I've come across so many. It's just ridiculous. And I'd read it and I'd study it and I'd say, you know, this doesn't really explain it. It doesn't. It kind of avoids it. I say, I don't want avoidance. I want it, suffering, to be explained. So thanks to the Holy Spirit. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Thank you, that inner clarity that knows and says, come on, keep trying. And saying other stuff, not good enough. Come on, keep trying. So does the body have to die? No, it doesn't have to. Can the body be transformed into a body of light? Of course. Anything's possible. Once you give up trying to manufacture evidence of annihilation for the body, then the body can function flawlessly. However long it's useful for you. It doesn't need to get old. It doesn't need to get sick. It doesn't even need to be vulnerable. And of course, most people will look askance at that and say, that's terrible. That's awful. I mean, no, do you think the world wants to escape suffering and death? No, they don't. They cling to it. The world clings to it like it's the most precious thing possible, which is a very strange thing. If you don't understand the explanation, once you understand the explanation, then you say, of course, that's why the world clings to it. And they don't like to see anybody who is not manufacturing evidence that the annihilation is engaged with their body. They don't like that. It gets them very nervous. So it's not so easy for like a perfect guru, a savior, master to appear in this world to someone. It's not so easy. Because people get very nervous. They say, wait a minute, where's the evidence of death on this one? Where's the evidence that annihilation has been engaged? I don't see any. And I say, oh my gosh, you know, it brings up this dread, like maybe I could, this might happen to me, and then annihilation will come after me, spirit, and annihilate spirit. So spirit uses bodies as a defense against the fear of annihilation, and then the decrepitude of bodies. So spirit's afraid to see some flawlessness, death-freeness, invulnerability. It's afraid. It doesn't want to come across anything like that. Unless it's raised all this up into the light of clarity and saying, yeah, it shouldn't be such much of a problem. Or if it is a problem, at least I know what the dynamic is. And so teachers leave us alone because they don't want to drive us into greater fear. Now, sometimes teachers take on a body and they let it age. They let it have sickness, they let it age. And then they explain it like, if I didn't do this, you would feel too much awe and nervousness around me. So I'm giving this appearance of the body aging, but it's just an appearance. It's just something I'm imagining. I'm letting the play of imagination play with this body for your sake, but really what I am is not aging or suffering at all. That's what they tell us. And now it's understandable. The whole thing's understandable now. Very simple. So, we do have to stay one step ahead of the times now. So, this teaching is not too advanced for the times. You might be thinking, wow, this is super advanced teaching. Well, it is, but it's not too advanced for the times. So, you have to keep this in mind. This is probably maybe the most important issue, is if you compare this teaching with previous teachings, you say, whoa, this is like super advanced. And then you start thinking, maybe it's too advanced, but you're comparing it to some past time. But it's being given out right now, these times. And this, ask yourself, is it too advanced for these times right now? And then you'll say, probably not. No. It's probably just spot on for these times. 50 years ago, too advanced. But now, no, it's not. Because we realize that there is this great drive in this world to give massive evidence that this boogeyman annihilator that we're imagining, that comes from our desire to be prime creator, which gives rise to the fear of annihilation coming towards spirit, that we want to put forth an enormous amount of evidence that this boogeyman annihilator is super engaged with bodies, with this world, and we want to manufacture an enormous amount of evidence, which of course means enormous amount of trauma, suffering, sickness, and death on this planet. The planet is aiming, that is the goal of this planet at this time, is to man, and so that it thinks that this is salvation, because spirit will say, oh, I'm so relieved. Look at all the evidence, a massive amount of evidence that the annihilator is super involved with bodies on this planet, etc. And that means maybe I can scuttle off somewhere and be free of this fear and misery. So that's the Antichrist way, the deluded way of trying to gain salvation, is simply trying to manufacture so much evidence of involvement of the annihilator being involved with bodies that we can conclude conclusively that the annihilator is completely fooled and we're scot-free. The annihilator thinks that it has annihilated reality and the self, and therefore it rests with its accomplishment. We think we can trick it entirely, you see, that way. That is not the path of salvation. That is the egoic, delusional path of salvation that gives rise to massive sacrificial situations. So we're heading pell-mell towards that situation in the world where there will be this massive global sacrificial type of situation of so much evidence, again, of annihilator engaging with bodies and annihilating them, bringing about their annihilation. Whereas if you see that this is all just a complete farce, that there is no annihilator at all, we're simply doing this to ourselves to manufacture evidence for nothing. It's completely farcical. You don't need to partake in this nonsense, this farce. You don't need to be in this farcical movie at all. You can say, hey, I don't need to manufacture evidence that an imaginary annihilator is engaged with this body, because there is no such annihilator. And everything that happens to me, I'm making it happen to myself. There's no annihilator that's doing that. It's just, I'm making myself vulnerable. I'm attacking myself. I'm bringing about attack upon myself. Now, it may seem that others are engaged in it, but the fact is, if we were not doing it to ourselves, nobody could harm a hair on our heads, as Jesus said. It's impossible. It's absolutely impossible for any harm to come to even to these imaginary bodies if it weren't for us imagining it to be so. And we don't have to imagine it to be so. We do not. Absolutely not. Do not. Do not have to play a role in this farce. So the importance of this teaching is that we're so close to the tribulation time. Where all this evidence is going to be, we're going to manufacture a huge pile of evidence, okay, to try and end this inner dread that spirit is feeling. We're very close to that, and so we need this teaching that lets the cat out of the bag entirely, and we say, what a farce. Well, how ridiculous is this? And so we don't need to keep playing this silly game. That's enough. And opt out of that silly game. It's necessary at this time to push it all the way through, all the way through. And it's easy to get. You can get it. And you can see, okay, now I see. Not a problem, not a problem. The only thing is we don't know how it's going to play out, but don't worry about that. Don't worry about it. Just rest in your assurance that it's possible to see it as it is. It's possible to see existence as it is on a deep level. Now, how it will play out on superficially, okay, that's yet to be determined. But do not dwell on that too much, because that saps your energy from staying one step ahead of it all. It's better to continue to rest in the fact and the knowing that you got it. Says, yeah, I got it. The mystery's been solved. There is no more mystery. I got it. And keep reinforcing that with yourself. Don't say, okay, but now how am I going to blah, 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 help others, all this kind of stuff. Try to minimize that. Don't go too far down that road. Just say, I got it. I see it. Mystery solved. There is no more mystery. I understand it all. And I can opt out of this. I don't have to continue in this farce. The body doesn't have to die. Doesn't have to be attacked. Doesn't have to give all this evidence. It's all manufactured evidence. We're doing it to ourselves anyway. It's all fake evidence. It's all completely unnecessary. There is no actual annihilator. Reality can't be annihilated. Can't be annihilated at all. It's imaginary. And so you can say, I got it. I got it. I got it. I got it. That's it. And just rest in that as much as possible. That's a great mantra. I got it. Mystery's been solved. I got it. Just try that. So you're not calling upon other questions or answers or anything. You just say, I got it. The mystery has been solved. I got it. Now I see the mystery has been solved. It's finished. I got it. Just rest in that without trying to think about anything else. Like, what am I going to say to someone else? How am I going to share this? How can I help others? How is the tribulation period going to play out? How is this, all this kind of stuff? Don't even worry about that. If you got it, you got it. And you just have to accept that you got it. It's the acceptance that you've done it. You've done it. That's what's important. If you don't accept it, then how it plays out is going to be different than how it plays out. If you accept that you have got it, if you accept that you got it, that is going to bring about a different play than if you don't accept it. So when you ask, well, what's going to happen? Well, that's dependent on whether you accept that you've got it or not. Which one are you going to choose? And how accepting of the fact that the mystery's been solved? How accepting of it? So that's really the task going forward. How accepting? Because the mystery's been solved. No more mystery. Life and death, existence, suffering, fear, misery, all this stuff has been solved. All in one neat little package with a bow on it. And we just have to accept that fact. So we'll see how it goes, how the acceptance goes from here. All right. Make this one a fairly short one. Very great. And this is, again, another tremendous breakthrough. Another tremendous breakthrough to just see it as it is. Just see it as it is. I see it as it is. I've seen it as it is. It's acceptable to me. I accept the fact that I got it. I accept the fact that I've got it. I'm finished. I see it as it is. Nothing more needs to be said. Just accept that fact. All right. Very great. That's it for this video.